not be put on amendment number 2. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this assembly acknowledges International Human Rights Day, notes the United Nations comments that more should be done to raise awareness of human rights and the need to improve education about human rights, and calls on all government departments and public bodies to introduce human rights action plans.
Margaret, thank you. Éirim Sir Sean Lynch an Rún a Bogu. I call Sean Lynch to move the motion.
We are pleased to have secured this debate today in the week that recognises International Human Rights Day, which falls on the 10th of December. It commemorates the day in which, in 1948, the United Nations General Assembly adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. The General Assembly also passed a resolution inviting all interested organisations to observe the 10th of December of each year as Human Rights Day, and that's what we are here doing today. The adoption of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights marked a milestone in the history of human rights. For the first time, it laid out fundamental rights for all to be universally protected. Today, 68 years later, the Declaration remains as relevant as ever. However, the omens for the present day aren't hardly promising. The economic crisis, which, with its potential for generating political instability, seems to be spiralling further and further out of control. In this environment, the vulnerable are more exposed and minority interests struggle to express themselves. The temptation is to be inward-looking and defensive for states as well as individuals. Human rights issues slip further and further down the agenda as choices are made and funds become more scarce. No. In this climate, we must remember that human rights are not a luxury. Our motion calls that more to be done to raise the awareness of human rights and need to improve education about human rights. Recently, as 2011, the United Nations adopted the Declaration on Human Rights Education and Training and acknowledge the fundamental importance of human rights education and training in contributing to the promotion, protection and effective realisation of all human rights. This year's Human Rights Day's slogan, "Stand up for someone's rights today, and everywhere and at all times. Take a stand, defend somebody's rights. Human rights belongs equally to each of us. Every one of us can make a difference." It is important that we debate human rights this week when we commemorate International Human Rights Week. This Assembly has a primary responsibility, realising the human rights of all people living in the north of Ireland. I pay tribute to all the leading human rights organisations, CAJ, Equality Commission, Human Rights Commission and Human Rights Consortium, Amnesty International, for all of their excellent work in this field. While in the north of Ireland we have an array of equality and human rights protections, we should be looking to build on those. It's often said that human rights are universal, and that is true. We have a Human Rights Act, an Equality Commission, a Human Rights Commission. The fact that legislation has to be equality and human rights proofed, and human rights organisations such as CAJ, Human Rights Consortium, all of this is reflected in the Good Friday Agreement. Nevertheless, we must always look at how we can be much better. It is always good practice to assess, review and evaluate where we're at in terms of rights-based approach and how we make that more effective and go further. It's important to think about human rights as being relevant to our everyday lives, and that includes public services and government departments. According to Eleanor Roosevelt, where do universal rights begin? In small places, close to home, so close and so small that they cannot be seen on the map of the world. Yet they are the world of the individual person, the neighbourhood he or she lives in, the school or college he or she attends, the factory, farm or offices where he or she walks. This motion today demonstrates this Assembly's commitment to enriching and embedding a human rights culture within the north of Ireland. Human rights must be defended to protect our privacy, our freedom of speech and our right to protest. It is interesting to note that the three recent UN reports, namely Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, UN Report on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, and UN Report on the Convention on the Rights of the Child, they recommended that the state party expedite the process of adopting the Bill of Rights for Northern Ireland and ensure that it is in line with provisions of the Convention and other international human rights standards. The Bill of Rights was a key part of the Good Friday Agreement. It was to build upon ECHR and to be legislative at Westminster. Sinn Féin calls on the British Government to legislate for a Bill of Rights. There have been many human rights recommendations made by the United Nations on a range of issues. Sinn Féin believes and adheres the highest standards of human rights is practice. It's important, the prevention of human rights abuses. The Scottish Government have stated they want to go beyond defending human rights. They believe protections offered by the human rights legislation should represent a floor rather than a ceiling. The Scottish Government has taken on the challenge to find ways to embed human rights responsibilities across different policy areas by producing Scotland's National Action Plan. The plan has several outcomes, including empowering every individual to understand and embrace the value of human rights, implementing Scotland's international human rights obligations, and reducing inequality of opportunity and outcomes. This approach ensures that people's rights are at the centre of policy making. In Scotland, Perth and Kinross Council ran a pilot project bringing together local people and public bodies to discuss the potential impact of human rights on individuals and local public services. One of the proposals coming from this meeting relates to education and raising awareness. It was viewed that people who might most benefit most from human rights are often the people who are least aware of them. This forum also provided the opportunity to see human rights as part of their daily walk, as opposed to only certain circumstances, bringing people together, think about their rights and their public services is potentially a hugely valuable approach. The Human Rights Act is an important part of this debate. We can't ignore the direction of travel in which the UK is going regarding the repeal of the Human Rights Act. This is something Sinn Féin opposes. The Human Rights Act plays a central role in our peace process. International human rights has always been very important for the people of the North, as it is truly objective and stands with what is right and wrong. The recent UN report about collusion in the North was another example of this objectivity, fairness and justice in practice, in addition to providing practical examples. Every year the Human Rights Commission produces an annual statement on human rights. I look forward to attending the event of that report this week in this building. This Assembly should take note of this annual statement and examine those areas indicating, with a view to reflecting them in the programme of government. To conclude, Priu Laskan Kolia, Mar Gaelgori, Bacorda Act na Gaelia Akur Arsul Gujeric. As a Gaelic speaker, I think the Irish Language Act should be implemented immediately. Gurmen Mayalgut.
Irim Sir Claire Bailey. Lasuahain Abogu. I call Claire Bailey to move Amendment 1.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'd like to just put on the record, first of all, that we in the Green Party are really glad to see this debate brought to the House, and we're supportive of the original motion. We've added a very slight amendment, and it is hoped that it has been taken as a friendly amendment, as it's aimed at reflecting the legal obligations for this Assembly's commitments to human rights, as well as the Westminster Government's. In the pact made available for this debate, there is a quote from the United Nations, already mentioned by Mr Lynch, that outlines the background for reasons to introduce an International Human Rights Day, and it states that in 1948, the adoption of Universal Declaration of Human Rights marked a milestone in the history of human rights. For the first time, it laid out fundamental human rights for all to be universally protected. Today, 68 years later, the Declaration remains as relevant as ever. That's a hard statement for us to disagree with today. But as the state signatory to this declaration, Westminster are, for all intent and purpose, the accountable government at both the international and domestic level for ensuring that these universal rights are afforded to each and every UK citizen. On the 22nd of May 1998, people across this island overwhelmingly supported the Good Friday Belfast Agreement, which was a legally binding democratic referendum. As the Second Amendment from the SDLP today also states, this agreement included the incorporation into Northern Ireland law, the European Convention on Human Rights, and the subsequent passage of the Human Rights Act 1998. The European Convention on Human Rights is really worth spelling out and having a look at today as we debate this, because we here in the Northern Ireland Assembly should be writing this into our laws since 1998. But they state some pretty straightforward things, such as the right to marry, the prohibition of discrimination, freedom of thought, conscience, and religion, right to respect for private and family life, but also the prohibition of abuse of rights. But under Section 2 of this Convention, there are a further series of articles setting out the operation and accountability for the European Court of Human Rights that includes the appointment of judges and their decisions taken. A series of protocols have been added at various points since, and these include Protocol 2 that furthers basic rights such as the protection of property, right to education, the right to free elections. Protocol 4 in 1963 introduces the prohibition of imprisonment for debt, freedom of movement, and the prohibition of expulsion of all nationals. Further protocols brought us all universal rights such as compensation for wrongful conviction, equality between spouses, right of appeal in criminal matters. The Human Rights Act has also been UK law since 1998. This means that you, as a human, as an individual, can defend your universal rights in a UK court, and that public organisations, including the government, the police, and local councils must treat everyone equally with fairness, dignity, and respect. It is slightly regretful that here in Northern Ireland, this is so many cases have made their way into our courts to test these. This is the same year that saw the introduction of the Northern Ireland Act, which sets out the legislative competence of this Assembly and prevents us from legislating in conflict with the European Convention of Human Rights. Now, I think it's really important that this House reaffirms our commitment to this, because over several years, observations of Northern Ireland from many international treaty bodies have repeatedly identified approximately 12 recurring human rights issues within this Assembly. And these are a single equality bill, a bill of rights, termination of pregnancy, Irish language protection, promotion of Ulster Scots, issues for Irish travellers, including educational attainment and housing, lack of involvement by the Northern Ireland Executive, poverty, conflict and legacy issues, the age of criminal responsibility, historical institutional abuse, and structures for participation. Access to many other human rights have been challenged in our courts. Some I've already made mention of, and others are currently being considered by our courts. It is for these reasons I feel it is important that we all need to be held accountable for what we do in our roles as public legislators. And this is why I feel it important that this amendment receives support from all members of this House. During a Westminster debate on International Human Rights Day last year, Jim Shannon MP stated that the Foreign and Commonwealth Office publishes an annual report on human rights as well as quarterly updates. May I suggest that we consider having an annual debate in government time in the main chamber of this House to coincide with the release of this annual report, giving the House as a whole the opportunity to respond to it? Well, Principal Deputy Speaker, I believe this to be an excellent suggestion, and may I suggest that we perhaps do the same in this chamber? Because we have strategies, we have reports, and they are one thing, but accountability and scrutiny are very much another. So I'd like to just again reaffirm that we, in the Green Party, want to take this opportunity to confirm our commitment to the European Convention on Human Rights as universal rights for all. Thank you.
Alex Ashwood, Lasua Doa Bogu. I call Alex Ashwood to move amendment number 2.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I think when the last time this sort of issue around human rights protections was debated in this chamber, I recalled something that struck me very firmly about 10 or 15 years ago, when a book was published in Dublin, and it said that the future of the island would be defined less by the bloodlines of ethnicity and more by the lifelines of human rights. And that's the perspective that the SDLP takes in relation to this debate and in relation to human rights generally. That the future of our island, we believe the future of the wider world, should be defined by the lifelines of human rights and less by the bloodlines of ethnicity. And that point, given the turbulence in many parts of the world at the moment, where ethnicity or other sectional identity seems to be holding sway, I think should be the perspective that we have on this particular issue. It is worth commenting, however, that perspective has, in our view, been more taken forward by the people in the rest of Ireland than by the government in Northern Ireland. Look at the Citizens' Assembly that has recently convened in Dublin. Look at the vote of the people of Ireland in relation to equal marriage. They seem to have embraced the argument around the lifelines of human rights. And whilst we would differ on some issues about what that should look like, that should be what we embrace too in going forward. The amendment that we tabled, Madam Deputy Speaker, refers to the provisions of the Good Friday Agreement and the incorporation into domestic law of the Human Rights Act. This is critical, not least given the ongoing Supreme Court challenge that started at 11 o'clock this morning. Because whilst the Human Rights Act is out with the European institutions, the Human Rights Act is not out with the Brexit debate and the future shape of our politics. And we want to put it on record and remind the British and Irish governments on record that there is a binding international treaty between the British and Irish governments, and that the outworking of that binding international treaty is the incorporation into domestic law of the European Convention on Human Rights and the Human Rights Act in particular. I'll give way, yes.
To the member for giving way. One of the most fundamental human rights is obviously freedom of speech, the freedom to express non-violent political thought. Does the member agree with me that it is absolutely wrong that people can come from outside of the United Kingdom to preach hate and incite violence on our streets, and because of the Human Rights Act, we're absolutely powerless because of their fundamental right to a family life, the government was hamstrung in efforts to put them out of this country?
And that was litigated upon, and the far side of that litigation, that I, if I remember rightly, went all the way to the European authorities. The right decisions were made in terms of where people who were preaching hate should go. But we also have to recognise that the Human Rights Act and international provisions generally have lifted the threshold of human rights protection that we are the beneficiaries of, and that whilst there will be cases that are, excite public concern, and in some places the media agitate public concern, that doesn't take away from the fact that we live in a better world because of the international provisions provided in Europe and through the UN and in other ways. And if you're making an argument like that, then you should step back from it and see the benefit that's come to you and to every citizen of Northern Ireland because of the provisions that we have embraced. But we're putting on the record that when the Brexit turbulence begins to escalate, then it's our view that the British government will barter votes in Westminster for the Human Rights Act and let them understand that the Human Rights Act is off limits, it's binding in international law, and it's an essential element of the new political dispensation in Northern Ireland. I might have misheard Mr. Lynch, and if I have, I'll stand corrected. But I think he said that this motion was the agreed executive position in relation to human rights. I might be wrong about that. And whether it is or is not, I'm worried about the executive position on human rights. And I'm worried by it for these reasons. First, in the SDLP submission to the PFG consultation, the SDLP outlined as a starter 50 bills that would define this mandate different from any other mandate of the Northern Ireland Assembly or of the old Stormont Parliament. It would see a paradigm shift when it came to legislative ambition and outcomes when it came to this Assembly. And it is not in the consequence of that is that our legislative proposals, 20 of them, were in terms of legislation. So whilst human rights action plans, if they are across the life of all government departments, and I'm sure the DUP will tell us shortly whether they are going to be across the life of all government departments or not, we need new legislation in order to build into the architecture of these institutions the human rights standards that we require. And I welcome the fact that Clare Bailey went through a lot of the thinking of the SDLP, which is also the thinking of the Green Party, in terms of marriage equality, in terms of early education and care, homelessness, financial redress for victims of clerical abuse, legislation to address age discrimination, legislation for a Bill of Rights and for an All-Ireland Charter of Rights, and so on and so forth. If there is to be a paradigm shift when it comes to a rights-based approach in this mandate, it is not going to come from a fairly moderate intervention like human rights action plans, welcome though they are. The paradigm shift will be defined by new legislation across the issue, across the range of rights requirements that actually says that we are embedding in the life of our politics and the life of our society all that is needed. The second reason why I think that what has been proposed is moderate is that what does it actually mean when it comes to critical areas of government policy? Let me give you just one example, because I won't have time for more. Because the PFG, not only is it limited and silent on what new legislation might be forthcoming in terms of human rights provisions, such as I and Clare Bailey have referred to, but what is worrying is how it goes about the issue of equality and anti-poverty. Because Mr. Lynch was right when he indicated that when it comes to policy and legal architecture, when it comes to equality and rights, Northern Ireland, over many decades, the work of many people who would pursue democratic practice when others pursued state violence and terror, created new thresholds when it came to equality and rights. But too many of the requirements are now missing from the PFG. Let me give you one example. The PFG must include a child rights indicator framework grounded in UN standards as recommended to the executive. Just one example. Yet the PFG is silent when it comes to that. And worse than that, when only a matter of weeks ago this Assembly debated the issue of child poverty, the DUP motion, supported by Sinn Féin, left out critical words of Seamus Tracy in the JR in July of last year, when he said that objective need had to be informed by neutral criteria, irrespective of affiliation or background, and that funding should be based upon those neutral criteria. Somehow the PFG is silent in respect to that critical phrasing, as was the amendment proposed by the DUP and Sinn Féin. So not only is the PFG lacking when it comes to legislative ambition, it is actually lacking when it comes to protect those hard-won gains in equality and human rights over the last 20 or 30 years. In my view, Madam Deputy Speaker, we are not that far short of what might well be a lot more turbulence when it comes to the issue of human rights. And the reason I say that is that at the end of February of this year, Justice Coghlan, who is the presiding judge in the inquest into the Ballymurphy massacre, will convene the parties and at that stage may or may not indicate whether he's able to move towards inquest. Now, that inquest is informed by international human rights principles, yet the court may be obstructed from pursuing that inquest because of a lack of money.
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
If it transpires that there's a lack of money come February when it comes to that inquest, then we will be in denial of our international human rights obligations. The court will be denied its opportunity to pursue the inquest, and victims and survivors will be denied the right to truth.
I call Philip Logan.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and of course I welcome the opportunity today in this House to discuss human rights. Of course, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I believe in human rights. I think we all in this chamber believe in human rights, and I, for one, am very thankful for what we have been afforded here in this part of the United Kingdom. I've had the opportunity over the years to travel to many different countries through various mission teams, and had the opportunity to see firsthand where people aren't afforded the same basic human rights that we have been. One memory that sticks out most to me was Mexico City. I travelled there with OMS, and I remember people sleeping beside water pipes over the night just to survive the night. I remember one young girl that I met in a park. She slept in the park, and she had a child, and she had no shoes, and she had glass stuck in her foot, but because of the healthcare system there, she had absolutely no opportunity to get that seen to and to get that fixed. And I still think about that girl, and I still think about that child and the sort of start that that child has had in life, not a very good start at all. So I believe that everyone should have a safe place to sleep. I believe that everyone should have access to clean water and to food. And as a result, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I agree with a portion of this motion, and that is to acknowledge Human Rights Day. And quite a few things have been set out already in regards to human rights, and I think that a day set aside to remember those people and those people who... Yes, happy to.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. Several speakers now have talked about how the Assembly lags behind in terms of human rights, but actually in one area where the Northern Ireland Assembly led was in the introduction of the Human Trafficking and Exploitation Bill. Slavery is a growing problem in terms of human rights violations, and it's actually to this House's credit that it took a lead on tackling modern slavery.
That's right, and I would commend Lord Morrow for his work on that.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. And I would commend Lord Morrow for his work on that. And I think that, along with other things, we are leading the way in regards to human rights on a lot of different issues, and I welcome the member's contribution to that. So I do agree with a portion of the motion in regards to remembering those people who haven't been afforded the same rights as us. Some of us in this chamber today also have a job to do, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, in regards to human rights. There are some in this chamber who, on one hand, would appear to champion human rights, but on the other hand are quite happy to deny the right of life to a child. Well, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, let me put on the record today that this party and myself will never be found wanting in regard to standing up for the unborn child. What I find particularly hard to palate about this motion today is here we have Sinn Féin tabling a motion on human rights, when some who in their party have denied the very right of life to many over the years. I spoke with a man just last week, a former bus driver who was targeted by the IRA, a man who for many years lived in fear, a man whose family were massively affected by it and to this day is massively affected by what happened to him years ago. I often think of families robbed of a loved one at the hands of terrorism here in Northern Ireland. What an absolute violation of their human rights and those victims' rights to life. So I stand today to oppose this motion. It calls for government departments and public bodies to introduce action plans. Yes, of course, that's the answer. More bureaucracy. No, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, this International Human Rights Day, I asked the people of Northern Ireland and this House to remember those who aren't afforded the same human rights as we are. And of course, I asked those in power, I'm going to finish up here. I asked those in power in those countries not to simply talk about human rights, but I call them to action so future generations can have a better start in life. Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker.
I call Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, I suppose I stand up and I look at this motion, and I look at it in its most general terms, and I look at it as something to celebrate. Celebrate the fact is that we do have human rights in this country and further afield, because we may not have if we hadn't signed the treaty in 1948, and we need to remember the reason why we had to sign a treaty in 1948 after the Second World War and the genocide that happened then. So I think it's something to celebrate, but I do know that there's much conflict in it, and there's an awful lot more to do. And I also look at the two amendments, and again I say, you know, what is there not to support in those amendments? We all must be, as good, decent human beings, wanting human rights for fellow human beings. So I can't see anything there that I would want to oppose, to be perfectly honest. The United Nations asks us on the 10th of December to show courage, and they ask us to stand up for people's human rights, speak up when another rights are at risk or under attack, if they're bullied, harassed or ridiculed, combat myths with facts, speak up for tolerance and against prejudice. So, I mean, these are all good things. These are bad things. I don't know how anybody can oppose things like that. The declaration in 1948 was a milestone, and the first article is all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. And we all know, and we could get into a slagging match across the floor, that our own recent checkered past has not lived up to Article 1. And neither have we lived up to Article 3, the right to life. But I see no point in trading insults around the place, because again I go back to the fact that I believe this is something that we should be celebrating. When we talk about courage, we all know about Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat on a segregated bus to a white man in Montgomery, Alabama, and sparked a civil rights movement in the United States. A little known fact that I found out, that actually she wasn't the first, but it was a woman called Claudette Colvin, and she wasn't used as the poster girl because she was a pregnant teenager to a married man. But it did show courage to say, no, my human rights allows me to have this seat. And of course, our human rights have been added to by the European Commission for Human Rights and the European Court for Human Rights. And it's interesting that today those European Courts for Human Rights is finishing the trial of Radko Mladic for the French Srebrenica massacre in 1995, the last of the war crimes. But as things have progressed, human rights have become slightly more complicated. Because Article 18 says everybody has the right to freedom of thought, conscience and religion. And Article 19 says everybody has the right to freedom of opinion and expression. And in words, absolutely, and I support that. But nobody could have envisaged that those rights would be afforded to the likes of ISIS, to Al-Qaeda, or to the Taliban, whose expression of religious freedom and opinion is in part a provocation for violence and repression, particularly against minorities and particularly against women. And who can forget the Charlie Hebdo attack? Who can forget the Bataclan massacre? And myself and my own experiences in Afghanistan, and I won't get into the rationale between that, but when you see a woman who goes in to vote and dips her finger in ink to vote and then comes out and the Taliban stand outside and cut her inked finger off, you will suddenly realise how much human rights we have here compared to so many others. These people preach hate, violence and anarchy, and I cannot believe that when we wrote the Human Rights Declaration in 48, 53 or in 1998, we ever intended it to support people like them. If I can maybe just conclude, Madam Speaker, What the human rights has given us is peaceful protests of assembly, rights to paid holidays, rights to privilege and a family life. But we also have to remember that 21 million people are still victims of forced labour, and 121 million people have never had the chance of an education. 300,000 child soldiers, of which I was one. I support the motion. I support the amendments.
The member's time is up. Thank you. I call Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. And while I appreciate that perhaps the irony of a motion on human rights being brought forward by Sinn Féin may not be lost on some in this chamber, I nevertheless stand to thank them for bringing this forward this morning, in recognition of the journey that they and others in this chamber have taken in respect of human rights in Northern Ireland and in the United Kingdom and around the world. Also, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, the Alliance Party intends to support the Green Amendment and the SDLP Amendment as brought forward today. The European Court of Human Rights, the Human Rights Act, the Good Friday Agreement, yes, our Good Friday Agreement, all underpins the pillars of the democratic positions that we find ourselves in today, the right for members to speak in this chamber and the rights of our citizens right across Northern Ireland. While Europe and all of its institutions can provide a great deal of confusion for many, the European Convention on Human Rights and the European Court of Human Rights are not the European Union. They are, of course, as others are referred to, the Council of Europe. It is the Council of Europe that is custodian of the Convention. A convention which we entered into in 1953. Indeed, in large part, the United Kingdom were the fundamental authors of the convention, and I, for one, am proud of that. A convention which, through the Council of Europe, represents not 28 states in the EU, but 47 states of the Council of Europe. And while the United Kingdom may be contemplating leaving the European Union, we are not, and the Prime Minister has made it clear, we are not leaving the Council of Europe. Our withdrawal from the EU will have and must not have any effect on our international convention requirements, whether in respect of human rights or many other international conventions which the United Kingdom is signatory to. Madam Principal Speaker, perhaps at this stage I should declare an interest because I play some small part in the Council of Europe as I represent this Assembly in the Congress of Local and Regional Authorities, and we too have a solemn duty to uphold that convention. Speaker, the Human Rights Act in 1998 brought into domestic law all of the rights and freedoms and protections of the European Convention on Human Rights for Citizens in the United Kingdom. Whatever the views of this House on a party which I may have some connection with, the Liberal Democrats in the last government, one of their achievements, I do believe, was in defending the Human Rights Act from the then Home Secretary Theresa May and her attacks on the Act in favour of a British Bill of Rights. Madam Deputy Speaker, it is today for the executive of this Assembly to commit to an action plan to ensure compliance with our obligations under human rights standards and to protect the Human Rights Act.
Did the member give way?
Yep.
Does the member hope, like me, that in protecting the Human Rights Act, that the First Minister will raise human rights in China during her visit this week?
I sincerely hope that
the member
whatever
has an extra.
Thank you. I sincerely hope that whatever opportunities any minister or representative of this Assembly has when they visit states who are not perhaps those which are fully subscribed to international standards on human rights, and we know that China is not, in those circumstances, I hope and trust, and indeed we should be asking the question of our First Minister, has she taken the opportunity to raise the issue of human rights? Yes.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. The member mentions his connection to the Council of Europe. The member will be aware that Human Rights Watch criticised the Council of Europe in 2014 for standing by while Azerbaijan, the regime there, cracked down on dissidents and opposition politicians. I assume he took the opportunity through the Council of Europe to condemn that indecision.
I was not a member at that point in time. However, I do wholly understand the flaws of all international bodies, and where they are found wanting, we need to speak out, and the member is right to do so. We in Northern Ireland have had our human rights enshrined in law, and Northern Ireland and Scotland have particular interest in any change to the Human Rights Act in the United Kingdom. Others, like Mr Atwood, have made reference to the relationship between human rights and the Good Friday Agreement and the international agreements that underpin all of that. We have all felt what it is to be a minority at one point in time or another of our lives. We can also and should also understand how the Act protects our right to freedom of expression, our right to a fair trial, and our right to freedom from torture and inhuman or degrading treatment. I do not want a United Kingdom government, either from the right or the left, to cherry-pick our rights. I firmly believe that the rights hard fought by through world wars and enshrined in the Convention since 1953 are so important and are so right and have been through the processes of the Good Friday Agreement given to the citizens, and we must always protect them from attack and they must never be undermined or watered down. The removal of the Human Rights Act in the United Kingdom would send out the wrong message internationally. As a country with a historic past and connection to our Commonwealth, we must make sure that we set the standard and that we try to educate and encourage others to meet those standards.
Can the member withdraw his marks to a close?
Yes. How can we encourage those other states if we are to remove or to water down the rights of our own citizens?
I call Christopher Stalford.
Thank you very much, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and I want to thank all members for their contribution to the debate thus far. I think it's been measured and reasonable. I'm very proud of the role that our country has had in shaping the world's understanding of human rights, going back all the way to Magna Carta, where the power of the executive over the citizen was checked for the very first time, even before the concept of a citizen existed, all the way through to the Bill of Rights in 1689, where the power of the monarch was curtailed. And we all know the background to the establishment of the UN Declaration on Human Rights, European Conventions, etc. The victorious Allies in the Second War had the opportunity to put the powers that be, who were responsible for so much human suffering, on trial to give account of their actions and the rights that they removed from other people. Arising out of that was an understanding of what I would call fundamental rights. And it's not necessary, I believe, for action plans for all parties to allow these fundamental rights to inform, guide and direct the things that they do. So what are these fundamental rights? Well, the first fundamental right that I believe in is the right to life. And unlike other colleagues in my own party, and I suspect around the chamber, I am opposed, I'm consistently pro-life. I'm opposed to the death penalty, and I'm opposed to anything like the introduction of the 67 Abortion Act to Northern Ireland. I carry my pro-life ethic with me, and it informs and guides and directs the things that I believe in. Freedom from torture is a fundamental right, and we must always guard against the power of the state over the citizen to impose inhuman constrictions or torture upon them. I mentioned earlier in the debate, and this is one area where I am very proud, I was a backroom boy at the time in DUP headquarters, but I had a role in helping the Lord Morrow in terms of the human trafficking bill, and I think we can be very proud of that legislation. It's designed to tackle one of the most fundamental rights violations that's going on throughout the world, which is modern slavery. It is ironic that one of the parties that's moving an amendment to this motion actually opposed that. In fact, just the one. One of the parties that's moving an amendment opposed that, and another that champions itself as a guardian of people's rights also was against it. The right to a fair trial in a free society is, of course, fundamental. And then freedom of speech, freedom of conscience, thought, religion, freedom of movement within the state that you reside, in order to guard against the establishment of a gulag system which operated in Russia. These are fundamental rights. These are the rights that I believe are shared, a belief in these rights is shared throughout the House by the huge majority of members. Reference was made to the Bill of Rights Forum. I have to say I served on the Bill of Rights Forum some time ago when it was producing its report, and the entire process was farcical. And it was farcical because special interest groups were using the Bill of Rights process as a Trojan horse to try and make fundamental rights out of things that are not fundamental rights. So, for example, some people were advocating that a Bill of Rights should be used as a means of reversing the trade union reforms that went through in the 1980s. Well, I'm sorry, there is no fundamental human right to secondary picketing. One of the fundamental human rights that was attempted to push through the Bill of Rights Forum was a fundamental human right to a home of your choice. Now, we obviously have a fundamental responsibility to ensure any citizen that needs housed is housed, but this is where I think we're in danger of going down a perilous path. I just want to finish with we have to stick to the fundamentals and understand what the fundamentals are. Just one quote from Philip Alston, the academic. He says, if every possible human right is deemed to be essential or necessary, then nothing will be treated as though it is truly important. And I think we must always guard against that.
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
I'm glad to do so, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker.
Éirim Saoir, Caoimhe Archibald. I call Caoimhe Archibald.
I welcome the opportunity to contribute to the debate on this important motion proposed by my party colleagues, and I also say that we are happy with the amendments being proposed and welcome the support that the motion has received from other parties. On International Human Rights Week, in this Assembly, we can make a real difference. We can explore the implementation and incorporation of the key international human rights treaties, for example, the Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities, the Conventions on the Rights of the Child, and the Convention to Eliminate Discrimination Against Women. Human Rights Day calls on everyone to stand up for someone's rights. This Assembly can explore how we as MLAs and legislators can embed human rights principles into everything that we do. Human rights treaties cannot be ignored. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, agreed by the United Nations in 1948, set out a list of 30 universal human rights. The UN has agreed a number of legally binding core human rights instruments. States which have ratified these instruments have specific obligations to respect, protect, and fulfil the rights contained in those instruments. Ratification of an instrument legally obliges a state to participate in a monitoring cycle and report to the UN Oversight Committee every 4 years or 5 years. Sinn Féin supports participation in the UN Human Rights Monitoring Mechanism. The recommendations from these are about everyday issues in small places close to home. For example, childcare, poverty, housing, education, and Irish language. They are the world of the individual person. A lot of issues have been raised by these treaty monitoring bodies. There are a number of recommendations specific to the North of Ireland in each of the three recent treaty reports, namely the Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, the UN report on economic, social, and cultural rights, the UN report on the Convention on the Rights of the Child. It has been raised about the lack of engagement with the UN reporting processes by the executive, in particular by the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. To quote, the committee regrets that the absence of representatives of the Government of Northern Ireland did not enable it to make a full assessment of the enjoyment of the Covenant rights in Northern Ireland. Les Allenby from the Human Rights Commission recently said that turning up to the Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, for example, means that we have a racial equality strategy that is acknowledged and given a positive recommendation. It is important that the executive is represented at these UN committees to tell the good news stories where they exist. Human Rights Commission, in evidence to the Executive Committee, suggested a coordinating role for the Executive Department for scrutiny of the concerns and recommendations identified in the UN reports that cut across all departments, be it justice, education, communities, health or others. The Equality Commission too have stated a scrutinising role for the Assembly committees. For example, recommendations on childcare should be fully scrutinised by the Department of Communities. The Assembly should and needs to take an active interest in all of this. The Human Rights Commission's response to the programme for government consultation sets out a variety of international treaty obligations and outlines where they fit in terms of law, policy and practice of the European Convention. It's important to note that in the most three recent UN reports, there are both concerns and recommendations made regarding three important areas: the Equality Act, the Bill of Rights and the repeal of the Human Rights Act. So let's stand up for somebody's rights today. Take a stand and defend someone's rights, because each one of us can make a difference. Gura Margaret.
I call Danny Kennedy.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I'm pleased to contribute to this important debate. Like others, the irony is not lost on me that the proposers of the motion are indeed Sinn Féin. It is sometimes difficult to take lectures from Sinn Féin on the issue of human rights, given their background. But one hopes that was in the past. But it is important that those issues are not forgotten. Principal Deputy Speaker, International Human Rights Day gives us the opportunity to reflect on what we've achieved since the Universal Declaration was first adopted 68 years ago, and also what work needs to be done both here in the United Kingdom and on an international scale, and how we can use our influence to improve the lives of those people living in countries that still have appalling records when it comes to the human rights of their own citizens. And it's important to remember the context in which the United Nations General Assembly adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948. Europe, we remember, had been torn apart by war and the genocide of millions at the hands of Hitler's Nazi regime, which had demonstrated the brutality that humans could visit upon fellow men and women. And the Declaration gave the universal protection of the rights of all for the very first time. And when you consider how just a few years before elements of humanity had demonstrated how little value they gave to the lives and dignity of their fellow human beings, then you get a sense of the enormity of that moment. And it is right, I think, that we refer to one such person who cared deeply about human rights was Austin Hunter, who very tragically died over the weekend. Austin Hunter was one of the outstanding broadcasters and journalists of his generation, but he was also a man of great humanity and compassion, who covered through his professional career some of the worst atrocities of the Troubles. But he did so with care and respect to those most deeply affected and with great courtesy. And I know that the House will join me in extending our sympathy to his wife Jean and family at this time. The theme of this year's International Human Rights Day is to stand up for someone's rights today. And in the past 12 months alone, we've seen the importance of defending the human rights of others, as we've witnessed that there are still groups and individuals out there who would hold little regard for human life. The rise of ISIS and the ongoing conflict across the Middle East, not least in Syria, have provided striking reminders of the importance of the Universal Declaration and the need for democratic nations to continue to uphold those ideals. The images of beheadings, of torture and slavery and genocide that have emerged from the region are a chilling reminder of the evil that can take hold when a nation does not embrace human rights. And of course, 24-hour media has now allowed us an insight into the conditions where people live in regions such as Syria and Iraq. But we must also be mindful of more secretive nations and regimes and their failure to adhere to human rights requirements. And it's important that when building relationships with other nations, the executive gives consideration to adherence with human rights requirements and makes this an important consideration when assessing whether to progress those relationships. And of course, I would urge those, particularly from the party proposing the main motion today, Sinn Féin, who of course recently rushed to pay tribute to Fidel Castro in Cuba, to consider how they could have tempered their words with a bit more of condemnation of his appalling record on human rights. And of course, the Liberal establishment nearly fell over itself to laud the achievements of a leader who gave scant regard to human rights and to those who opposed
his regime. Can the member bring his remarks to a close? Regime.
So broadly speaking, Madam Deputy Speaker, we are content with the motion and indeed the amendments and will give our support where needed.
Éireann Sir Richie McPhillips. I call Richie McPhillips.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to participate in today's debate and I rise in support of the SDLP's amendment. I'm glad to contribute to this debate today and I welcome, like Mr Dixon, the fact that Sinn Féin are proposers of the motion. It has to be said that indeed this is progress, as their past history has been anything but grace and glory in terms of human rights. We only have to look at the history of the Troubles and see that their military wing give little respect to the most basic of human right, that of the right of life. And we also recall the disappeared and the abused. Families like the McVeighs and Dunnockmore, just outside Dungannon, still, like other families, await the return of their loved ones, and individuals like Maria Cahill still seek human right or the human right of justice. And we also have the unlawful killing of Paul Quinn in South Armagh. These situations, along with many, many more abuses on both sides of the conflict, need to be addressed, and they're critical human rights issues, and they need to be addressed now. With regards to today's motion, Madam Speaker, the SDLP, a party formed out of the civil rights movement here, would like to join with other political parties in this Assembly in supporting International Human Rights Day, and we welcome the United Nations slogan of Stand Up for Someone's Rights Today. Madam Speaker, it's been 68 years since the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights. That was signed by most governments in the world, but it remains concerning that abuses and breaches of the most fundamental rights continue to grow. Freedom of speech and human rights are taken for granted in the UK, but in recent years and in months, we have seen human rights deteriorate on an international stage. In the Islamic world, women lack equality, religious dissenters are persecuted and political freedoms curtailed. In China, we have political and economic repression. In the states such as Russia, Turkey and Hungary, we have authoritarian leaders with little respect for even the most basic of human rights. The LGBT community in places such as Russia and Nigeria have faced oppression. Meanwhile, in the US, which is meant to be the pillar of Western civilization, it has failed to distinguish legitimate from illegitimate when targeting terrorist groups such as ISIS and others in the Middle East. Xenophobia and racism is also growing across Europe. The protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms, Madam Speaker, is therefore as relevant today as they were ever been. And it's concerning that in Northern Ireland, over the past 18 months, the Executive Office has failed to send any departmental officials to reporting committees to three major international treaties, one involving the rights of the disabled. Madam Speaker, turning to today's amendment, the SDLP has brought it forward as we have genuine concerns over the future realisation of human rights in the north of this island. The European Convention for Human Rights, enshrined in the Human Rights Act, has played and continues to play an important role in the delivery of peace here by ensuring that the state is not acting ultra vires and that it is held accountable for the gross violations such as those committed during the Troubles. I take that intervention now.
Cormac Ogut.
Thank you very much for taking the intervention. Firstly, I think I've heard enough across this chamber, but particularly from yourself, Mr McPhillips, in terms of trying to say that somebody in these benches is guilty of violating human rights. Now, if you have any evidence that I violated anybody's human rights, I think the good people in Mid-Ulster would like to know about it, given that they've elected me. And I think that people across the chamber have been very abused this issue to cause insult to people sitting in these benches, and I don't think there's any call for it.
I thank you for your intervention.
The member has an extra minute.
And I leave others to decide upon what I've said, and I don't mean anything personally about any individual in this House. But these rights, Mr. Speaker, Madam Deputy Speaker, are now a threat to the Tory agenda to quell all things European. Now that includes the right of fair trial, the right to liberty, and the right to have the death of a loved one properly investigated.
I appreciate the member giving way. You talk about being against anything European. These rights existed long before we were in the European Union, and there's no reason or logic in saying that they wouldn't after we leave the European Union.
Thank you to the champion for Europe. We have seen much progression in the realisation of these rights in the North, but this progress in judicial activism is now at risk due to the debate over sovereignty, and it will be for the people of the North who will lose out most. It's my worry, Madam Speaker, that if the Tories get their way, we will witness a massive chilling effect of human rights law in the UK. People's freedoms could be at risk, and if there are to be a British Bill of Rights, there would be a limited means for the redress. The European Court provides the last court of appeal against the state. We would simply be handing back control to the English judiciary, which has mistreated people from the North for years. In conclusion, Madam Deputy Speaker, I welcome today's motion on Human Rights Day, an important day for many suppressed peoples across the world. However, more locally, I do have serious concerns over the future of the Human Rights Act and the future of the Good Friday Agreement. I urge support for today's amendment. Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker.
Paul Jim Allister.
There are many fundamental human rights, but there is the absolute human right of the right to life. And it's written in the Universal Declaration at Article 3. Some have referred to the irony of the source of this motion today. I refer to the hypocrisy of the source of this motion today, because it comes from a party which has gone out of its way over many years to justify and to stand over the denial of that absolute human right, the right to life. Take the proposer of this motion, Mr. Lynch, an unrepentant convicted terrorist, convicted when he was caught by the SAS in April 1986, seeking to plant a landmine with murder in his heart to kill soldiers on the road to Rosslea, for which he got 25 years, but sadly only served half of that. It could only happen in Stormont that someone would have the audacity to stand up unrepentant of their own attempts at denying human rights, to propose a motion on human rights, and to clutch to themselves the clothing of human rights when they stand convicted of possession of explosives with intent to endanger life, possession of a rifle with intent to endanger life. And who, if he'd had his way that day, would have delivered murder to a passing patrol of soldiers? Of course, it's interesting to reflect that on International Human Rights Day, the 10th of December, the CMIRA has robbed many individuals of that most absolute human right, for which we hear no apology today. 10th of December 1971, two UDR soldiers, a Protestant and a Catholic, Kenneth Smith, Daniel McCormick, murdered by the IRA on International Human Rights Day at Clonay. The very next year, 10th of December 1982, a soldier, Stuart Middlemass, murdered by an IRA booby trap at Fort Mona Barracks. The very next year, on International Human Rights Day, James Heathcote, 21-year-old soldier, shot by an IRA sniper in Leeson Street. 1980, Colin Quinn, on International Human Rights Day, the 10th of December, shot by the IRA, leaving his work. And yet, some who to this day have no apology to make for their own actions or the actions of their comrades in delivering murder and denying the fundamental right to life have the audacity to come to this House and to cloak themselves in the language of human rights and to talk about defending International Human Rights Day. Where were the human rights of Kenneth Smith, Daniel McCormick, of Joseph Parker, of Stephen Middlemiss, of James Hesketh on International Human Rights Day? They were denied them, primarily by the IRA. And in April 1986, the proposer of this motion would have denied the same human right if he hadn't been stopped in his tracks by the SAS. So for the very reason of
the... Can the member please bring his remarks to a close?
For the very reason of the stench of hypocrisy that arises from the source of this motion, I will vote against it.
Éireann Saoire Nicola Mallin. I call Nicola Mallin to wind on amendment number 2, and Nicola Mallin will have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. This week we have International Human Rights Day, and there was universality across this chamber in recognising the importance of marking this day and taking the time, particularly during this period, to pause and to reflect on the harrowing experiences of those right across the world who live in an existence where they are denied their human rights. And Mr. Logan and Mr. Beattie in particular shared some very personal memories that they have, having themselves witnessed what that existence means, and in particular the pain and the suffering that is endured by children and women right across the world in particular. There was also agreement across the chamber on the importance of reflecting on how far we have come as a society in terms of compliance with human rights standards and the Human Rights Act. But sadly, that's where agreement ended. As Mr. Logan informs us, the DUP will oppose the motion and the amendments before us. Yes, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, we have come far, but as many speakers have highlighted, there are several areas where we still fall short. And I add my voice to those of members from other parties who welcome the efforts to bring a motion on this issue to the House. And I think it's important to also acknowledge and recognise the view that members have expressed around hypocrisy in terms of the proposers. I think it would be foolish and unrealistic not to acknowledge that, while I do accept that it has caused considerable discomfort and unease across the benches. But I also welcome the fact that there is support for this motion, that there is support for this amendment, as indicated by all parties except the DUP. It is important given that the European Convention of Human Rights is a requirement of the Good Friday Agreement and a fundamental part of our hard-won architecture here, that both are explicitly referenced in the final motion. This is more important, I would argue, given the hostility by the current Tory government, and in particular the Prime Minister, to the Human Rights Act, and the turbulence and the stirring of hostilities as a result of Brexit. I think it was Mr. Atwood who made the point that life on these islands and across the world is increasingly being shaped by the lifeline of human rights and less by the bloodline of ethnicity. This is an important development, but its progress requires effort. It requires, as many members have pointed out, education and awareness raising and campaigning. And I would like to echo the praise articulated by several members in terms of recognising the efforts of the many organisations and agencies working tirelessly to promote and protect human rights here and abroad. But I have to say, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, we have heard a number of times the slogan and the framework within which we are to view this year's International Day for Human Rights. Stand up for someone's rights today. And yet, not a single minister in this executive felt it worth their time to make the very short journey from their offices down into this chamber to stand and respond to this debate. And I have to say, That, for me, is the most disappointing aspect of this debate today. And regardless of the contributions that we have all made, for people, for the citizens in Northern Ireland, for anyone with an interest in the issue of human rights, to be looking in here today to see that the executive didn't deem it worthy or important enough, I will indeed.
For giving way, would you also agree that if the issue was being taken so seriously, the leader of her own party would be here instead of posing for a photo opportunity in London? Yes, I know you were going to tell me where he was. Instead of posing for a photo opportunity in London.
And the member has an extra minute.
Thank you. And I thank Mr. Stalford for his intervention. If he had have been listening during the debate, he would have heard quite clearly, and he prides himself on understanding the history and the politics of this particular part of the island. The Good Friday Agreement and its links to the Human Rights Act and its convergence around our membership of the European Union is all inextricably linked. In showing leadership today, my party leader is over in London at the High Court trying to protect and stand up for that right and the democratically expressed consent and wishes of the people of Northern Ireland. But, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, as I say, it is bitterly disappointing that not a single minister could make the effort to come down today to respond to this debate. And it also shows that on an issue of such fundamental importance, human rights, it's how we manage our society, how we protect our most vulnerable, the DUP and Sinn Féin are completely and utterly split. And I think that's a very telling and another very, very disappointing outcome and realisation from this debate today. Thank you.
I call Stephen Agnew to wind on Amendment number 1, and the member will have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Since the whole debate about the EU and indeed the Conservative policy of taking the UK out of the Human Rights Act or repealing the UK Human Rights Act, I think we felt the need in these debates to talk about the threat of that, the threat from the UK government to human rights in this part of the world. But I think as today's debate shows, the threat is here. The threat is much more local, because despite the Human Rights Act and despite our responsibilities within that, we are not meeting minimum human rights standards in many areas, and I know my colleague Claire Bailey highlighted those in her opening remarks. Mr. Dixon rightly raised the issue of human rights in China, and our First Minister should be raising challenges as to the very significant abuses of human rights in China, admittedly extreme in many cases. But to give ourselves credibility to lecture and to admonish others, we need to ensure in Northern Ireland that we uphold the human rights standards that we are signed up to, both through the Good Friday Agreement and through the UK Human Rights Act. We're well aware of the Human Rights Commission challenge around reproductive rights in Northern Ireland and the court ruling that we are not meeting minimum standards, and indeed we had the opportunity to correct that in this Assembly, and unfortunately that opportunity was not taken. The right to marry for same-sex couples is currently being tested in our courts. Again, we have the possibility to legislate, and indeed a cross-party group of MLAs are seeking to bring forward a joint private members' bill to do just that. But we know that in each debate that we've had to date, there has been a rejection by some of the extension of marriage rights to same-sex couples, and indeed the blocking by the DUP of a majority vote in favour. In 1998, with the Good Friday Agreement and the protections that went with that, Northern Ireland became the exemplar of rights. We led the game. We enshrined through that the protections through Section 75, and this led the way within the UK for others to follow. Unfortunately, we have done little since then to build on that foundation, and we've now become behind the rest of the UK and indeed Ireland. And our failure to bring forward, to even seriously discuss and consult on a single Equality Act has meant much of the updating of rights legislation across the UK, across other parts of the UK and Ireland, have left us lagging behind. And indeed, the access to those rights that a single Equality Act can simplify, again, has been denied to our citizens. And of course, others have spoke about and rightly speak about the legacy issues that still remain outstanding in Northern Ireland and the rights denied to the victims of our conflict here. Human rights are for all. The Human Rights Act is for each and every citizen of the UK. It is something we should not only uphold, but something we should embrace, something we should be proud of. We should be promoting human rights to other parts of the world. We should be acting as an exemplar. Our amendment calls for minimum human rights standards for Northern Ireland. That's the least we can ask for. It's not enough. It's not the embracing. It's not the champion of human rights.
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
But we believe this Assembly today should at least commit to that very modest outcome.
As I return to the debate on International Human Rights Day, I call Mr. Cockle Boylan to conclude and wind up the debate, and the member has 10 minutes. Mr. Boylan.
I rise to speak in favour of the motion on both the amendments, Mr. Speaker. This week is International Human Rights Week. I welcome the motion to the House. It is unfortunate that for us living in the North, human rights is still uncertain. We cannot celebrate International Human Rights Week without confronting the concerns on the potential repeal of the Human Rights Act. Deputy First Minister Martin Guinness, in question time to the Assembly, stated any attempts to displace the European Convention on Human Rights and to repeal the Human Rights Act will have enormous implications, particularly for compliance with the Good Friday Agreement. Any lessening of human rights laws, and specifically the repeal of the Human Rights Act, would be a grievous breach of the Good Friday Agreement and would mean that the institutional architecture of that agreement was seriously undermined, particularly in respect of policing and justice matters. This Assembly has the ability to pass legislation relating to equality and human rights. Equality and human rights legislation has been passed in Britain, Scotland and the 26 counties. How do we ensure that the people of the North of Ireland do not have lesser rights than those other jurisdictions? There is a need to introduce equality legislation in the North of Ireland. This is an issue that has been raised in 3 UN committee reports. Equality protection includes issues of race discrimination and ethnic minorities. The Executive's desire to make people's lives better and to deliver improved well-being to all citizens. The absence of an Equality Act impacts on those who are most disadvantaged, on people with disabilities and on children and young people. In the context of the International Human Rights Week, it is important to highlight the Equality Commission identification of disparities between equality legislation in Great Britain and the North of Ireland. This includes the following. The Equality Act simplifies and harmonises legislation on discrimination across grounds. The definition of race in GB includes colour, nationality and ethnic of national origin. Age discrimination extends beyond the workplace in GB. Disability legislation is stronger in GB, such as the inclusion of discrimination arising from disability and protection of people, harassment when accessing facilities, goods and services. Equal pay provisions are stronger in GB, prohibiting employers to forbid employees from discussing pay to establish differences. Positive action measures are permissible in GB across all equality grounds, and protection from discrimination by private clubs is extended to more equality grounds in GB. The Equality Commission, in evidence to the Executive Committee, stated that in GB the Equality Act 2010 has already been enforced for 6 years, and each year, in some shape or form, we are falling behind in our equality protection. This is the International Human Rights Week, and we have to ask ourselves, in the absence of an Equality Act and Bill of Rights, and in light of concerns raised by the various UN reports and the Deputy First Minister's comments on the repeal of the Human Rights Act, how can this Assembly enhance the protection of human rights and equality in the north of Ireland and ensure we do not have any diminution of rights? This year, Human Rights Day slogan is Stand Up for Somebody's Rights Today. In our Programme for Government framework, one of our outcomes is a more equal society. Let's take a stand and make a difference and maximise opportunities to promote equality and human rights. With your indulgence, Mr Speaker, I'm going to turn to some comments made by some of the members. And I mean, I thought it was quite a reasonable debate. Obviously, some of the contributions, I honestly think there's some unnecessary commentary on it. And I want to pay a tribute to the mover of the motion, Sean Lynch, who is mandated from the good people of Fermanagh South Tyrone to stand here and represent them. And I don't think some of those comments was made. Some people want us to go back to the past, and I don't think the comments were very helpful at all. But I want to just start with the move of the motion in terms of the biggest part of his contribution, obviously, is the issue of human rights and them slipping down the ladder. And this is against a background of austerity and everything else, but I think he's made the key point. There's been a good discussion here today, and we have to keep this on our agenda. In terms of the mover of the First Amendment, I thought it was quite a good contribution. Clare Bailey has mentioned the issue of the European Convention on Human Rights, the right to marriage, the right to respect for private and family life. And I think she also mentioned Protocol 2 as well in terms of protection of property. But I think a key point she mentioned was the actual issue about the annual report and putting it on the floor here for discussion in future years. I think that's quite a good suggestion. Turning to Mr Atwood, who's moved Amendment number 2, I mean, the basis of most of his approach was about, my recollection, is about actual legislation and us bringing forward legislation here in this Assembly itself. And I think that was a good contribution, and I think he's right. Some of the stuff that he's mentioned in terms of chartered rights and homelessness and everything else, and I think that's something we have a responsibility. After all, we're a legislative assembly. Mr Philip Logan, who's not in the chamber at the minute, and also Doug Beattie made very good, positive personal contributions and their own experience, and I think they've resonated with some of us as we listened to some of those contributions. And he talked about also, Doug Beattie mentioned the likes of Rosa Parks and her contribution, and I want to thank him for that, for the positive contribution that he made. Stuart Dixon talked about the Council of Europe, and he doesn't seem to think that we may have an issue. I genuinely do think, and we've talked about this in the Executive Office Committee, I think there are genuine concerns because nobody knows what's coming forward. Nobody knows about the Brexit issue or anything else. So nobody can tell us and look into the future what exactly is going to happen. We haven't even invoked Article 50, and everybody's turned around and saying that there's going to be nothing wrong with this. I think we have grave concerns. Christopher Stalford talked about fundamental rights, the right to life. He's opposed to the 67 Act. It's just a pity that the other parties don't feel the need to, or don't feel that they can support us at this time across the floor. Quive Archibald, in most of our contribution, talked about exploring the Convention on the rights of people with disabilities, the rights of the child, and also the rights and discrimination against women. And so also called for Equality Act, the Bill of Rights, which many members who made contributions talked about that as well. In turning to Mr Donny Kennedy, and I want to thank him for his contribution, he said that we have made some progress, but he recognised also that there's more work to be done. Mr McPhillips and Mr Allister, well, I mean, what more can I say, you know? Was that any more and make you cry in some of the contributions that we made? But, Mr Speaker, I'll conclude that, and I want to support both the motion and both the amendments. Cormilla Margaret.
Members, before I put the question on amendment number one, I would remind the House that if it is made, I will not put the question on amendment number two. Question, therefore, is that amendment number one, standing in the names of Stephen Agnew and Claire Bailey, be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Order. Members, the question is that amendment number one in the names of Stephen Agnew and Claire Bailey be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. Do we have tellers? Order. Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Stephen Agnew and Claire Bailey. Tellers for the noes are Adrian McQuillan and George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Members resume their seats. The members resume their seats. Clerk, please read the result.
91 members voted, 57 members voted aye, 34 members voted no. The amendment is made.
The amendment is made. Unfasten the doors. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. Clear the lobbies. Order, members. Order. I've been advised by the party whips, in accordance with Standing Order 27.1A(b), that there is an agreement that we can dispense with the 3 minutes rule and move straight to the division. So I now call for tellers. Do we have tellers? Tellers for the ayes have been appointed as follows: Cathal Boyland and Sean Lynch. Tellers for the noes are Adrian McQuillan and George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The House will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Thank you. Secure the doors. Order. Members resume their seats. Clerk, please read the results.
92 members voted, 58 members voted aye, 34 members voted no. The motion is carried.
The motion is carried. Unfasten the doors.